My name is Dr. Oluwaṣọlá Afolabi. I'm a senior lecturer here at WEDEC. I'm really looking forward to this session. And if you can kindly make introductions about yourself and where you're from in the chat, that will be helpful so that we'll be able to coordinate discussions better. I'm pleased with the three presentations that we'll be having, one in Zambia, one in Nepal, and I think the last one is probably we're going to find out, but I'm quite pleased with the range of discussions that we are going to get from this. Okay, without much ado, I think I'm going to start the first presentation on market assessment of point of use of water treatment in semi-urban and rural Zambia. By Emily Rand. I've noticed your email, Emily, and so I'm going to act accordingly. I'm going to escalate you to a moderator, and hopefully we'll be able to have a fruitful discussion. Right, okay. Just going to start it.
Greetings from Zambia. My name is Teresa Bwala, and I'm from the Ministry of Water Development and Sanitation.
And I'm Emily Rand. I lead UNICEF's WASH program in Zambia. Today, we're going to share some results of a market assessment we did for point of use water treatment in semi-urban and rural Zambia. But first, let me start with some background. The entire water sector has only 3% of the funds needed for WSS, and over 70% of that comes from donor partners. As per the annual statistical bulletin of Zambia, 29% of boreholes are non-functional, compared to 25% in the region. In 2023, 13% of healthcare facilities had an urgent need for water. At that same time, 16% of schools lacked water. Evidence has long predicted that climate change will bring too much and yet also too little water to Zambia. Climate change is also predicting rising temperatures and predicting that that will bring increased cholera and malaria. We're already seeing that to be true. This year, we had the largest number of cholera cases recorded in a single year. As shown in the image below, the National Stadium was turned into a cholera treatment center. This year, we've also had the lowest rainfall ever recorded for a February, and rivers had a quarter of the flow from the previous year. Droughts has led to limited water and electricity, which has led to unsafe water collection. Even in those places there is water, that often needs pumps to get the water to people. And given the limited electricity, this means that there are often either long lines or people have to risk collecting water at night if there's only electricity during a few hours in the middle of the night.
In rural areas, we actually do test the borehole water before handing it over to the beneficiaries in order to ensure that it is free from contaminants at the point of collection. However, studies have shown that for most parts of the world, biological contamination still happens during transport as well as storage. In some urban centers and even a few rural communities and healthcare centers, efforts have been made to ensure that water remains free of fecal contaminants through online as well as manual chlorination. However, in Zambia, even the largest commercial utility has been unable to ensure that residual chlorination throughout the pipeline is achieved. While we try to improve those larger systems, 68% of the population who use hand pump, well, or surface water, point of use treatment is proving to be the only option to ensure that water is free of coliforms. The market assessment also showed that there are many options in the region, and some of which have passed WHO as well as UNICEF testing. We also found that suppliers in the capital who could provide several of the options, however, most of them were too expensive for rural and semi-urban customers. In the rural communities as well as semi-urban areas, we only found that chlorine and boiling were the two modes of treatment which are actually being used. A survey was conducted on 336 households in three districts of Lwakhula province, and InfoQuest found that while 81% of households perceived water to be relatively clean, 29% of these households surveyed used chlorine, whereas 5% used boiling as a mode of treatment for most of their time. Some market products are available to improve water boiling in the capital city. However, given that less than half of the country has electricity access, electric hot water heaters is not even an option in most locations. Also in Zambia, there have been many issues surrounding the issue of cutting trees for fuel and charcoal, which must be considered when promoting boiling water. However, the private sector as well as the organizations promoting safely managed water are encouraged to explore these other options. Considering that chlorine was the most common way to treat water, as reported, we looked into this area more. We discovered that 5 large companies in the country could either manufacture the raw soluble products, or they could buy the chlorine overseas and liquidate it by themselves, or they could simply dilute and bottle it in the country. And one was originally supported with USAID and Population Services International. The chlorine, which was distributed to groceries, pharmacies, as well as retail general dealers, and even some gas stations. For most rural areas, the price doubled to 75 cents, mostly due to the cost of transport. A focus group of the market assessment focused on 33 groups, and the key informant interviews were conducted in about 5 districts, which was completed by InfoQuest, and it was found that in more rural markets assessed, the typical traders were small informal shopkeepers with very limited stocking capacity. The shopkeepers also reported that stocking limited chlorine qualities were due to low sales. On average, the general shopkeepers could only make 5% gross profit of the end market value. In order to determine the willingness to pay, UNICEF, in conjunction with InfoQuest, conducted activities with 114 households in 5 wards in Lopla province, and the willingness to pay for water treatment products was estimated at approximately 50 cents. Most households noted that chlorine was sometimes given out at healthcare facilities. This made most households believe that it was the responsibility of healthcare facilities to provide this product for free, and therefore they were not willing to pay for the product.
Until we reach Sustainable Development Goal 6, we will still have a risk of cholera and other preventable outborne diseases in Zambia. This market assessment has established that promoting point-of-use water systems in semi-urban and rural areas presents an opportunity for us to move from the Millennium Development Goals, which was just access, towards the Sustainable Development Goals of more safely managed access. However, we did find that the current options cost more than rural communities can pay. We do think that now is an opportunity. As the risk of cholera outbreak showed us, there is now an increased knowledge of waterborne diseases and contamination risks. This creates a potential to grow customer demand for accessible, effective, and easy-to-use water treatment solutions tailored to semi-urban and rural communities. We are so thankful for those members of the private sector who are already working on this issue, and we call on more private sector actors to add water treatment options to their supply chains and come up with innovative solutions. We are grateful for the government for the large aggressive targets and open transparent data that they share, but we urge all actors to consider their actions and how they may be contaminating groundwater. And lastly, we urge you, WASH practitioners and donors who are watching this today, to stop buying single-use bottled water, but start treating your water when you are in locations where the water is not safely managed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emily, for the presentation. That's a more like a call to action based on some of the things you've discussed. Emily, are you with us? Can you hear me? Let me just send you a request. Lukundo. Is Teresa? I think Teresa is here. I'm trying to find Teresa. Okay, yeah. Let me make Teresa a moderator. Can any of you hear me, Emily? Can you hear me? Right, Emily. Good to see you, Emily.
Oh, you can even see me? Really? Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can see you. I think the last time you made a presentation, you were probably in
Vanuatu. Oh, great. Okay, cool.
I think you were in Vanuatu or something. Now you moved to Zambia. That's good.
Yeah.
Keep the good work up. Okay, fine. Questions for Emily? Right. There's a question from Chris saying that other than boiling and chlorine, are there other effective or sustainable household water treatment methods you can think of that should be promoted?
I really want to defer to others, if that's okay. Lucundo's there. Is Teresa also there? I'm not sure if we were able to let them in, but I know Lucundo's ready to answer as well. So maybe we can have him in on that first one. So some of the co-authors who weren't in the video also get to speak, if that's all
okay. Right. Okay. Yeah, Lucundo and Teresa, over to you. Are there, other than boiling and chlorine, are there other effective, sustainable household water treatment methods that you should think should be promoted? Lucundo and Teresa. I think Lucundo is with us, yeah? Lucundo Simwaza. Did you get the question? Can you hear us, Lucundo?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now. Thanks for your presentation. And Emily has transferred the responsibility of answering the questions to you. And Teresa, I think the question is there any other household water treatment method other than boiling and chlorine that could be promoted?
Okay, thank you very much. So earlier highlighted, our market assessment basically looked at various water treatment methods at the household level. So yes, we have other methods that could be promoted, such as Sodis. There are some products on the market that allow for water treatment using the solar disinfection method. So there are quite a number of other methods that could be promoted, but obviously we have to take into account the willingness to pay by the communities, but also the technical capacity of the households to operate and maintain those treatment options. Thank you.
Any thoughts on that, Emily?
Well, I guess I chimed in the thing that you can see from what we found in the study for what's appropriate for Zambia. But it's true, the context is very different in different locations. So personally, I'm a big fan of filters. That's what I use in my own home. And I carry a filter with me everywhere I go. And I have one right here with me actually right now, because that's where I always, I'm always filtering my water everywhere I go. There's a filter inside. So I think there's lots of options, and you have to think about what is market and appropriate for the location where you're at.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much for that. There is a question from Will Tillett, and Will is interested to find out if you have any insight as to what is needed to further grow also the treatment market in rural Zambia. And in the context where there are occasional free distribution of chlorine from, I think, Ministry of Health or during cholera, how can we have consistent customer demand where free distribution can undermine the chlorine market or willingness to pay? I think the first one is, how can you promote household insights to growing household water treatment in Zambia before we go into the second question? Any insights? Emily, Lucundo, and Teresa. I think Lucundo is muted.
Let's let Teresa chime in on that one, and then I'm always happy to say
Teresa. I've tried making Teresa a moderator, but I don't think she's accepted my request. So if you don't mind, I'm quite happy for you to provide
the response.
Yeah.
Okay, I hope Mufwe and Teresa will also type in the chat as well their thoughts.
Yes.
But I think in general, You know, we've done, found in other studies for other products that actually the free distribution can sometimes have a positive effect for those who do have the willingness to pay. And I think we actually found that here in cholera in Zambia, that honestly, the supermarkets, so many rural pharmacies, they all actually are selling chlorine products for sale, and hardware stores here are selling filters. And so there is a willingness to pay for different markets. And so I think we found with toilet use that when we promote toilets and maybe give a toilet to a poorest household, it actually has a net positive effect that other people will build toilets too. But if someone knows of other studies that prove me wrong, please put them in the chat. But my feeling is that the Ministry of Health actually giving away those products to those most in need really creates that demand and builds trust in the product. So I think it's a good thing. And I think that continued social marketing, that continue making sure that the products that are at the right price and the right place are promoted in communities where at a price point that they can afford. And for some places that means subsidies. So right. Did that answer you the question? I can talk about this forever.
Okay. Right. Okay. That's Lukundo. Any thoughts on that before we go to other questions? I think there is a question from Mahamud Amonto. It's a, what are the conditions that contribute to the attainment of sustainability and resilience in water treatment, particularly in your context? Mm.
Lukundo, what do you think?
So, what are the conditions? What are the conditions that could contribute to the attainment of sustainability and resilience?
Okay, I would love to throw that one to Teresa for her to give an answer to that one. I hope she's on the call. Teresa, are you here?
I appreciate the way you guys distribute your response, and I know you want to be inclusive, but we have very short time, and I think it would be good if we can get a response, okay?
Sure. I'll chime in, but everybody else, I hope you type in the chat. But I think, I mean, sustainability is a real issue, especially where products aren't necessarily affordable. And I think that is the big question. And so are there, we're doing cash transfers as UNICEF for other parts of our program. And is there a need to link with some of that kind of work from some of the World Bank and the government of Zambia themselves are giving out that cash transfer? And is there a need to somehow link with some of that options? Because cholera is going to come again. I mean, we're expecting floods next month, and so we will be in a cholera situation again. So we have a lot to do. But again, everybody, if you have ideas, please share them with us on how we make that sustainable. But I think the market-based approach for those who can't afford it is part of the solution of sustainability, which is why we did this market assessment, because some of the population can afford it.
Interesting. Violet asked a question. Did you explore factors that determine household willingness to pay?
Yes.
Are there factors? Okay. And what are those? I presume you are the main presenter.
Okay, fine. I won't keep tossing. I so wanted government to be able to answer their thoughts too. Yeah, so I think there was actually a slide that showed some of those different factors, and maybe we'll post those in the paper afterwards so that you can see some more of those factors. But I think willingness, like, and the promotion and trust in products and trust and belief of how long that product will be good for and how long it will actually be sustainable. That actually is a big factor. People in knowing that they're investing in something, and we found that how long they thought the product would work and its durability was a really big key. I know other studies have found things like the usability, how easy it is, and how low maintenance it kind of is easier. And for me personally, that's like a factor in why I use filter versus chlorine the everyday input. But we kind of found those the same things other studies have found, basically. Sorry. You know, durability was a new one, but the other ones of how ease of use and cost were all factors in the willingness to pay.
Ease of use, of course. Cost is always a key one. I think I'm going to take this last question from Elizabeth, and it was quite interested in finding out how the variation in terms of preference, either boiling or chlorine in rural and semi-urban areas. Is there a particular preference for one method over the other? And also, did you assess any potential risk of recontamination after boiling or incorrect dosing of chlorine?
We actually didn't get into that level of studies with this, but I think those are all really good questions that lots of people come do your PhD thesis in Zambia because those are all really good questions to further study.
Well, that now you are now throwing that into my area because anytime I hear the word PhD and an opportunity, I'm very, very keen to explore that further. But I think these are really, really interesting questions and how to ensure that you address some of the barriers to adopting this solution at household level and the risk of recontamination, because if that is not addressed, then it has a very strong correlation with willingness to pay. People just come back and tell you, I tried it, it didn't work, this is still happening, and I'm not going to buy anymore. So I think we can pick that up and maybe scope something around it. I think the most important thing when it comes to PhD is the funding. Oh, I forgot you're from UNICEF, so we're going to get some funding. That's good. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm going to continue, but there might be a question for you after. So let us go to the second presenter, and then we can take it up from there.
Okay.
Right.
Let me just tell my co-authors to answer the questions in the chat. Answer other questions, please.
Okay. Thanks. Yes, please. Lukundo and Teresa, please. I know you're from the government, so please try and continue supporting Emily's work and put your answers into the chat. Thank you. Right. Okay. Let's go to the second presenter and probably the last one, because I'm told that the third presenter is not here. And so we will be listening to John, who will be talking to us on self-supply in Lahan municipality in Nepal. Can household tube wells provide a safely managed service? Interesting question. Right. Okay.
Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is John Light. I work for WaterAid and I'm presenting a paper today that was developed jointly with my colleagues Dharma Chitragar and Tara Badnik. I'll be sharing the results of a detailed water quality survey conducted in Lahan municipality in Nepal and looking at issues of self-supply and whether this can provide a safely managed service. So starting with some context, WaterAid has been working in Lahan for the past 6 years as part of the Beacon project. This is a long-term water operator partnership between Anglian Water and Nepal Utility NWSE, together with the local government and the Ministry of Water Supply. The project focuses on Lahan, which is a municipality with just over 100,000 people in the southeast of Nepal. The aim of the project is to achieve universal access to sustainable wash services in the municipality, and thereby to create a model which can be replicated in other municipalities and NWSC branches. So why did WaterAid conduct this survey? The Beacon project has mainly focused so far on working with NWSC to improve and expand access to pipe water supply in the urban centre. Substantial progress has been made, and the number of household connections has increased to nearly 5,000. Which represents an increase in coverage from 15 to 23% of Lahan's population over the past 5 years. However, the 2021 census showed that across the municipality as a whole, 70% of the population rely on shallow tube wells for drinking water. So despite the progress made by the NWSC, it's likely that the majority of the population will continue using shallow tube wells in the near future. Yet there's very little information on the water quality from these tube wells. And so therefore, WaterAid decided to carry out a detailed survey, including water quality testing at the well and at the household, a sanitary survey of the tube well, and a household questionnaire on knowledge, attitudes, and practices. This paper asks whether household shallow tube wells can provide a safely managed supply. As this slide indicates, the results show that many of the criteria are met. The tube wells are an improved source. Nearly all of them are accessible on premises. 97% were located within the household compound. 82% were used by only one household. and nearly all are available when needed. Only 5% of households reported that their water source is unreliable. In terms of water quality, only 6% of households had ever tested their well, but 95% perceived that their water quality was acceptable. The survey also showed that nearly all of the tube wells are self-supply, i.e. constructed by the household without outside help, and almost half had been upgraded to include a small electric pump as well as the hand pump. Overall, the tube wells were deeper than we'd expected, and so as you can see here, the cost of construction represented a significant household investment. Moving on to the sanitary survey, the results showed that there was a high risk of bacteriological contamination. Most of the tube wells performed poorly. A fundamental challenge in self-supply is that households construct a toilet and a water point within their compound, so it's almost impossible to achieve the minimum required separation. And combined with poor source protection and a shallow water table, this points to a high risk. Similarly, there were challenges in household storage. Water was often stored in open buckets, with a utensil used for collecting the water. An awareness of water quality risks and practice of household water treatment were both low. Water quality results show that E. coli was present in over 5% of tube wells and 8% of household samples. This was perhaps lower than we'd expected. There's still a cause for concern and plenty of room for improvement. Turbidity in the tube wells is very high. Half the samples exceeded the national standard, and 14% had turbidity 10 times that level. A lot of the above may not be particularly surprising, but a key finding of this survey was that there were significant chemical contaminants in the tube wells, particularly arsenic, manganese, and iron. These pie charts show in red the proportion of samples exceeding national standards, and then in orange those which were also above the more stringent WHO standards. For arsenic, 7% of samples exceeded WHO standards. However, it was found that these were clustered in certain areas or hotspots. So in some of the wards, a much higher proportion of tube wells were above their limit. There were also 4 tube wells with high levels of lead. There were no instances of high nitrates. But overall, this is a concern for 2 reasons. Firstly, arsenic, manganese, and lead can all lead to serious long-term health conditions. And secondly, these chemical contaminants are much harder to remove at the household level, so treatment options may not be available or affordable. So coming back to the question of whether household tube wells can provide safely managed water, we know that the tube wells are an improved source, and to show nearly all of them were available on premises and reliability was generally good. When you look at water quality, the JNP definition of safe considers 3 parameters, free from fecal contaminants, i.e. E. coli, plus arsenic, plus fluoride. Fluoride was known not to be an issue in this part of Nepal, and so it was not tested. On this definition, the tube wells performed well. 91% met national standards and 87% WHO standards. However, when you consider all 5 chemical contaminants that WHO defines that have an adverse impact on health, so arsenic and fluoride plus nitrates, manganese and lead, then this drops dramatically to only 29% or 22% for WHO standards. As we've shown on the previous slide, the principal problem here is manganese. This was previously considered to be a nuisance parameter, i.e. affecting the colour and taste similar to iron, but there is now growing evidence that high levels can cause neurological effects in infants and young children. Finally, if we take all 10 parameters that were tested in the survey, then the percentage of tube wells meeting national standards drops right down to 11%. user satisfaction and preferences. There are three key things to consider here. Firstly, that user satisfaction was relatively high. 83% rated their supply as good or very good. And when asked specifically if they had any challenges or complaints, only 22% cited a problem. The most common issues raised were water quality, the effort required in pumping, and an unreliable water source. Finally, the survey also explored why some households may choose not to connect to a pipe water supply where available. The biggest issue was the cost of connection or tariff, followed by the status of having their own pump, and preference for the water quality from their tube well. That said, in the rural areas where there is currently no piped supply, 95% of households said that they would be willing to connect if a pipe supply was available in future. As a result of the survey, a number of recommendations were made. Firstly, improving water quality surveillance in Lahan, providing access to water quality testing for households and integrating that into future surveys, and making NWSE's water quality data publicly available so that customers can make informed choices. And also regulation of private vendors, as the survey found that a higher proportion of households in the town were now buying bottled water. Secondly, improving access to safe water sources. There are still over 7% of households in Lahan left behind those using unimproved sources like open wells. Also working with contractors to improve the siting design and construction of tube wells, and groundwater monitoring to determine what depth boreholes should be drilled in future, both from a reliability perspective and also to access aquifers with better water quality. Also recommendation for further work to look at the barriers and drivers for connecting to NWSE's supply. And thirdly, to review, adapt and expand the work on hygiene behaviour change to incorporate findings from this study. Finally, some recommendations of issues to discuss at national level, to liaise with other partners such as WHO to support more widespread surveillance of water quality, in particular looking at some of these chemical contaminants in the Terai region. But this has to be matched by solutions for households, finding low-cost, effective and sustainable treatment. And thirdly, work to professionalise the manual drilling sector in Nepal with appropriate standards, which would help to reduce bacteriological contamination and turbidity. And to conclude, finishing with a question, whether the JMP definition for safely managed water should be updated to include all five chemical contaminants identified as priorities by WHO. As we've seen in this study, that would make a massive difference in highlighting the very low proportion of the population actually with access to safe drinking water. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the presentation. John, yeah, great. Thank you very much for the presentation. There are questions already for you. I think the first question is, what was the source of the high levels of chemical contaminants, arsenic and manganese? Did you? Oh, I think, let me see.
Does that work now?
Yeah, that's fine. You can turn on your camera, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, brilliant.
So these chemical contaminants, arsenic, manganese, the iron, these are all naturally occurring. What we would call geogenic sources found in Lahan and across various areas of the Terai region in Nepal.
And before, I mean, if you want to ask any question, please feel free to maybe raise your hand. I'll give you the audience. But while people are still constructing their questions. Your response is okay, but I think you also mentioned in the presentation that you've just left us hanging without any current effort in addressing this heavy contaminants. So what is the current effort in that space in terms of removing these contaminants?
Yeah, sure. So on the bacteriological contamination, that is something that we, you know, can address and are addressing. So we've got a hygiene behavior change program in Lahan. So yeah, raising awareness about the location of the tube wells, protection of the source, and the safe water chain in storage, treatments at household level. So that's something that we are working on and can improve. The chemical contamination is much harder. And that is partly why it's still hanging, because there's not an easy solution. We've discussed it with the municipality. And I mean, we are also working with the utility, NWSC, to offer pipe water connections to people. And we're actually conducting another study now, looking at some of the barriers and drivers to connection. But we recognize that extending pipe water services to everyone will take time. And so that was really the purpose of the study, was what do we do in the interim? Some people are kind of taking matters into their own hands and buying bottled water. So there was a big difference between the urban and rural areas there. In the urban areas, we found 40, 50% of people were buying bottled water. As we've heard, that's maybe not a long-term sustainable solution, and it's not affordable to everybody. There is some work in some areas of Nepal. There are filters available for removing arsenic and iron. So these are kind of modified biosand filters. So that's something which is available, and we can look at working with the private sector on that. Manganese is much less common. I think it's a kind of contaminant growing sort of awareness that this is a public health risk. So we're not aware of many filters that address that. We have installed some in schools from a supplier in Nepal, and we are monitoring the performance of that at the moment.
Thanks for that. I think what the logical next question is already asked in the chat, that how have the household responded to the findings of this contamination, and is that part of what you've done to explain to them? I know you mentioned you've approached municipality, but have you approached them, and what response have you been able to see with respect to that? Because everybody knows that some of these contaminants are really, really dangerous to health.
Yeah. So, we've seen a big increase in connections. So, because this survey was done last August, September time, there was a big increase in connections to NWSC over the past 12 months, but that was driven particularly by reliability of the water source. So last year, the monsoon rains were delayed, some of the shallow tube wells became dry, and so that was one of the big driving forces. I think still water quality is not a... we heard that public perception of water quality was very high. People didn't necessarily perceive it as a problem. So people had, that's also perhaps lack of awareness, and also what people have grown up, this is what they're used to, that the water's turbid, there's some coloration. I think this is still... We know that hygiene behavior change will take time. It's still an area for us to work. We surveyed 735 households But obviously, this is indicative of a much bigger problem across the municipality. So how we reach all of the households with awareness of hygiene issues and water quality will take time.
Will take time. Do you see there is an urgency for that? Because I mean, and I think my concern with respect to that gap, municipality might not want to do anything about it if you don't urge them or if you don't drive it. And I guess that is one thing that probably links to what Violet is asking, that if contaminants are naturally occurring, then the community have been exposed to them for quite a long time. Is there a study in the area to document the effect this may have on population? Because you can mobilize that to substantiate your findings and make people. I think that public awareness gap is still there.
Yeah, and I think one of the things with chemical contaminants is it does take a long time to see the effect. So it's not necessarily it's harder perhaps for people to draw a link between the cause and effect. We did discuss it with the health in charge in the municipality, and he is doing further consultation with the respective health in charges to see if there are any documented cases of people with arsenic poisoning. But he wasn't himself very aware of that. So I appreciate that. I mean, there is further work for us to do here. We, as WaterAid and Beacon Project, we've made a long-term commitment to this area. So we're going to be there for another 6 years. But we're, you know, also looking to work with other partners, maybe WHO, maybe UNICEF, to improve some of the water quality surveillance, because we feel, I mean, what's happening in Lahan is just one small municipality. This is, again, indicative of a much wider issue across the Terai region, which we feel has not had the same level of perhaps recognition as in Bangladesh, where there's much greater data and awareness about arsenic in particular, but other contaminants.
Right. There's a question from Mahamud. Hi, John. If water are salt and chlorination is too high, it's harmful to a human being? I really don't get that question. I don't get that question. Please, Mahamud, if you want to retype the question to make it clear for John, that would be helpful. I'm going to go to Neho. I have a question regarding the water quality in Myanmar. Okay, this is a focus on Nepal, but let's see. When back in 2018, 2019, when we were trying the Myanmar RWS team, you might see the situation of water quality in Myanmar from pilot to Department of Rural Development. Any suggestion or comment after 5 years? Right, I presume this ties you to some previous projects. I'm not sure if you want to quickly say something about that, but I think the focus here is on Nepal. But if you have something to touch on that, that's fine.
Yeah, I mean, I used to work with Nayu, so it's nice to hear from him again. There was much less data on water quality in Myanmar. There are some areas of Myanmar where arsenic, particularly in the coastal area, arsenic is an issue, and more hydrogeological studies are needed there. But what we were mainly focusing on was testing for E. coli, and I think that a similar issue that shallow household tube wells are widely used in Myanmar. And there's a huge amount of work to do. The levels of E. coli that we saw, they were much higher. So looking at, as I said, because it's bacteriological, as we saw in the first presentation, options such as boiling or sodis or relatively simple filters or chlorine you know, all of these are feasible at quite low cost. But yeah, then there's a lot of work to be done there still.
Thank you very much, John. Any question for John? I'm going to turn the gun around and ask you, okay, right. Mahmoud has revised this question. I meant if water, salt, and chlorine are overdosed in side water, it's harmful. I'm struggling to understand that question, Mahmoud. Do you want me to... maybe I make you a moderator and you'll be able to ask your question. Let me give you the mic. Maybe that will be helpful. Okay, so while that is while we're waiting for Mahmoud to join in, I'm going to turn the gun. You have a question to end your presentation, and I'm going to turn the gun around. Okay, sorry.
Hello, Solo.
John, please go ahead.
Can you hear me? So my question is this. If the water it is salinic and chlorine it is put it overdose into the water, when you drink, you test it like the salty, and it to be harmful in a human being?
Salinity was not an issue in this area.
So John is answering our question that salinity was not a problem in this area.
And we were not doing any chlorine.
I mean that in South Sudan.
So the focus here is Nepal. But if you want a specific question with respect to South Sudan, I'm sure maybe John will be happy to take that on free. He won't charge you. But I would say, if you have something relevant to what we're currently discussing, then it will be helpful. But I think John did mention that in Nepal, they don't have any problem with salinity. So it's a different ballgame. I think they're dealing with something much more tricky there in terms of the metals that they are seeing in their water. So I think we have a virtual cafe. As part of this conference, you can always connect with John to ask questions there, okay?
Also, just to add...
thank you, Sol and John. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Also, my colleague Dharma Chitrakar is on the call, and also Tara. So Dharma has actually been... is based in Nepal and spent a lot of time in Lahan, so just... I want to give the opportunity if Dharma would like to add anything about the follow-up work being done.
Dharma, if you can hear us, I think we'll be interested in the question with respect to how to plug that awareness gap on what John is picking up in the water and how the household are reacting to that. Or is this something you think it's not worth exploring?
Hi everyone, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Dharma.
Great. Thank you, John, and thank you, Sola, for the opportunity. It's a very good question indeed, and some of the follow-up actions after, you know, like this report has now been published, we are in a very close communication and, you know, like dissemination within the respective municipality, not limited to the municipality board, but spreading wide to the, you know, like individual wards as well. So at a level of understanding to the, you know, like the decision makers at the local authorities, they have now realized, you know, like there are the certain hotspots within the municipality that needs special focus, and the priority for the pipe water supply needs to be focused more on these spots as a very high priority projects. And at the same time, at the federal and the provincial level as well, we are planning to have a broader discussion how we can learn from these findings, not only specific to the context of Lahan municipality, but as John rightly mentioned, how we could capture this in the wider, you know, like the Madhes province level as well, with the support from both, you know, like provincial ministry and even the federal ministry. So there are a series of actions that is in plan for the future, which is more, you know, like focused on the findings from this report. Yeah.
John, you've caused a lot of problem now. You've brought out some critical things, and I think it's quite interesting to note that there's no existing work that have been done looking into, like you said, this geological induced chemical contaminants in Lahan or in a bigger municipality or even scaling it further. Is that something that has been done, or is that a scope for that as part of future plans? Dama.
Should I respond? Yes. Yeah. Thank you. So on a bigger picture, actually, the Nepal do have the geological maps of the entire country. And but with the learnings that we have working with the Nepal Water Supply Corporation Lahan while constructing the deep boreholes, we even find, you know, like a distinction between, you know, like individual boreholes and their, you know, like the geological characteristics within the small region as well. So definitely within the Beacon project itself, we do have another work stream or the bigger outcome areas where we talk about the bigger water security issues as well. So we are more tied up with the provincial ministry in this manner, and a comprehensive workshop had happened last year, where, you know, like a series of, you know, like research questions was raised, and, you know, like which most probably will be asking for these questions about, you know, like how the geological formations, subgeological formations, and are affecting these water quality, because it depends on the different aquifer zones, and, you know, like how we could best monitor those in the longer term government's own program as well.
John, any thoughts on that? Because it seems to me people are just citing wells. They didn't go back to some of these mappings that have been done.
Yeah, there is more data on arsenic. And I think a big study was done, I don't know, in the past, looking at arsenic and the certain areas of the Terai that is known to be a problem. But what I particularly wanted to highlight from this study is some of these other contaminants, particularly manganese, have in the past not even been tested because it wasn't seen as a health concern. Manganese was seen similar to iron as a kind of nuisance parameter. It causes discoloration, but it doesn't have an impact on health. But what we've seen this year is, there's been a lot more research on that. And in March this year, WHO published these new guidelines on water quality for small water supplies, which identify five priority chemical contaminants. So in addition to arsenic and fluoride, they added nitrate, lead, and manganese. So I feel that this is a really important question for the sector. Do we need to expand water quality surveillance to include those parameters? But if we do, we also have to sort of match that with viable treatment options as well. Because if we tell people their water's contaminated, but we don't offer them an alternative, it's not helping that much. So I don't have all the answers to that. As I said, we are working with one vendor who has a treatment option for manganese, but it's more suitable for like institutions or community level, not household level.
That was a question I was going to turn the gun back to you. You ended your presentation with that question. Should we include this priority contaminants in GMP? What do you think?
Ideally, yes. I mean, I'm sure JMP would say it all comes down to cost. And,
of course.
And of would course. Also say it's up to national governments which parameters they choose to monitor. But I feel that what I wanted to sort of highlight is perhaps there's an underreported issue here, because safely managed water only considers E. coli, arsenic, and fluoride. If we are taking more parameters into account, the people with access to safely managed water will drop. And we saw in this study that actually it makes a massive difference. If you only look at arsenic and E. coli, it was 91% of potable water. If you added manganese and lead and nitrate, it dropped to 29%. So it's a big difference.
Tara has just complimented your point. When we had someone from WHO, they didn't have plan as to yet to update the GMP designation in line with these new guidelines. And I think I think you have a point there. I think we, okay, someone is putting something in the chat, Elizabeth. Okay, yeah. Sorry. I'm just reminded I'm getting carried away with the conversation and the engagement. I've just been told that we have 5 minutes left. But I think I see it as the future. And I must commend your work because a lot of people who are working in this setting are faced with a lot of resource challenge. And to be able to do something comprehensive, people just focus on E. coli. And the question I always ask is, there is more danger beyond E. coli. Okay, fine. You want to make very quick decision-making. You want to reach a very quick decision, but you need to look at the broader perspective of things that also pose danger to and risk to people. I can keep on talking till I've been told I have 3 minutes left. But any question for John and Dharma and Tara? I think Tara has kindly requested that if there are studies and best practice to which people are using to address manganese at household or community system, please feel free to reach them. I think there is a need for that here. Of course, it has to tick all the boxes of low cost, affordability, and things like that. But yeah. Okay, quick plug before we close. WaterAid have recently released another report on what we have been doing supporting household with self-supply in other countries, if you're interested. Okay. Yeah, if you're interested in additional work being done by WaterAid, that's helpful. Any other question for John and for Dharma or for Emily and the team from Zambia? Very interesting presentations. We didn't take the third one because the presenter did not send their presentation. So that's why we've only focused on John and Emily. Any other question? Right. Thank you very much for your presentation, John. Very, very rich. And good luck. I think you need a lot of it at the next phase of the work. And thank you, Dharma, for joining us from Nepal. Emily and the team from Zambia, thank you very, very much for your work on chlorination and boiling and odd option and low-cost options in Zambia. And I wish you all the best for the rest of the conference. Thank you very much.